Yeah, he's known to go off, right?
I always feel like everybody thinks you belong somehow to Alexander.
Yeah, I mean, I just actually only did half his movies.
Yeah.
Second half.
And you've done a bunch of other directors that you've done two or three or four movies.
That's true. Well, Mangold, I've done more than Alexander. I think I've done four. Identity, Walk the Line, 3:10 to Yuma, yeah. And Night and Day. So four.
Yeah.
Two with Clooney, but three if you count Descendants. Which is where George, you know, kind of saw how I worked with Alexander. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, he liked that. He just, because we have similar styles, I mean, or Alexander, I should say, it was sympathetic to our working process, to the way George likes to work, which is, you know, pretty simple, not too much preconceived sort of storyboards or planning. Mm-hmm. It's very, you know, actor friendly, of course, you know, it's the performances are so the center point of what happens on set, and we just do a blocking and bring people in and rehearse, and then they leave, and you know, it takes maybe a minute of us deciding, mm-hmm. okay, we're gonna do this and that, you know, it's not like super complicated shots, but just the fact that you know, we're fast, we're efficient, we don't shoot a lot of shoe leather, I mean, everything is pretty much put together the way it's going to be used. Mm-hmm. Alexander is very precise the way he has it in his head, of course, most of the time, having conceived it and written it, so he's really thought about it, you know, right. A lot. And George is the same way. He knows exactly mm-hmm. what he wants. He, you know, we do, I mean, the two shortest shoots we ever have were, you know, our George's movies and Alexander's. They usually, you know, I mean, with George, sometimes we have 5-hour shooting days, you know.
Hmm.
And the crew is always in shock. They don't really like it. They don't make as much money, you know, because they don't go into overtime. And, you know, I mean, they like it because they get to go back to the gym and then sit at the bar at happy hour. But we were, you know, on Monuments Man in Berlin, we were, you know, the German crew was like, oh, this is the first time we get to pick up our kids from kindergarten, you know, go to the park. Mm-hmm. And so he liked that. And it was actually on Descendants, on the dance floor at the halfway party, that George asked me if I want to do Ides of March. But yeah, Alexander.
Was that like a proposal? Was that like a, you know?
It was
prom?
Weird. It was weird. He was, you know, kind of, you know, I think he didn't really, doesn't like officially asking, you know, he just feels like
he give you so candy, he was just and kind flowers.
Of dancing up next to me. So, you want to do my movie? I'm like, sure. But, yeah, so with Alexander, I mean, you know, perhaps people say that because we know each other for probably 25 years.
Yeah.
I interviewed with him to shoot his student film when he was at UCLA, his graduate film. And I met him in a small apartment in Hollywood, and we always kind of lived in the same neighborhood. We lived in Silver Lake or Los Feliz. There was the Onyx there next to the Vista. It was a coffee shop where, you know, we would just run into each other over the years. But I didn't end up getting his student film. But I got some other UCLA graduate film. I didn't go to film school, but you know, everybody, most of the people think I went to AFI because most of my crew at Roger Corman were AFI guys, like Janusz Kaminski, Mauro Fiore, Wally Pfister, you know, all the Academy Award winners. They were crewing for me when I was shooting Corman films.
Hmm.
But I did do a UCLA graduate film, and Alexander ended up being the boom man on that. And I remember, it's just the only thing really I remember about him, that he was a terrible sound man, you know. And the boom was in the shot all the time. And but so we know each other for a long time, but then he had Jim Glennon, who shot his first three movies, and you know, other than us just running into each other occasionally, you know, we didn't really ever talk about working together, but you know, I knew what he's doing, he kind of knew right. what I was doing. I was doing my, you know, bigger sort of commercial movies like Phenomenon and While You Were Sleeping and things like that, and so
and
we weren't in the same world. Hmm?
You shot his first film.
No, I didn't get that job.
Turteltaub's, no?
I started with Turteltaub. I did four movies with Turteltaub. The first one was Driving Me Crazy with Thomas Gottschalk, Dom DeLuise, Billy Dee Williams.
And that wasn't his first feature?
He had done Barbarian Brothers before, which I missed, unfortunately. But he was straight out of USC, and I was at Corman, and And then we ended up at Motion Picture Corp, which was Brad Kervoy, Steve Stabler, and they formed a company called Motion Picture Corp. Brad used to be Roger's lawyer, I believe. And they asked me to do, Trouble Trouble or Driving Me Crazy, which was Turteltaub's movie with Thomas Gottschalk. And I didn't really want to do it, but they say, if you do it, we'll give you a pay or play directing deal. So I did it, and then I directed Sketch Artists with Drew Barrymore, Sean Young, and Jeff Fay. So that's how I started directing early. I was like 29 or something.
So was directing a high priority for you? Was it something
I mean, it's just like the first, I've directed five movies, but most of them are just sort of, you know, they're not really, I'm not really an auteur filmmaker at this point. I've just, you know, they came about in various ways. And I do enjoy it. I think it's helped me as a cinematographer because you really, it puts what you do as a cinematographer in perspective. Often as a DP, you think, you know, I'm kind of the main guy on the set. I'm doing everything. I'm running. I'm setting up a shot. I'm lighting. But then when you really direct the whole movie, you realize there's a lot more to it. First of all, this endless development and tweaking the script and casting and dealing with financiers and then of course, you know, post and editing and music and it really makes you understand, if you've been in the editing room on a feature, it really helps you, I think, shoot a movie because you realize, well, all these shots are great individually and they're beautiful and just can't use them, can't take up that much time and and it's really helped me, and I'm always happy to go back to shooting. You know, it's something I like to, you know, balance out and go
every
back
every few years.
Fun.
You want to get your people.
Yeah, you know, sometimes I mean, you look. Sometimes I mean, I've been fortunate enough. I work now with this pretty much, like you said, the same group of directors that I know, and we've developed a chemistry and a relationship now with Alexander. The third movie, it's really become a great collaboration. You know, we don't, of course, have exactly the same aesthetics, which are good, you know, because we complement each other. I really know what's important to him, and I try to bring, you know, as much, you know, visual and cinematic language to those stories without getting in the way. That's the key, you know. You don't want to really take people out of it with the visuals and.
So what is it that, I mean, what is the relationship? You have four or five of these relationships where you have multiple movies. I mean, is it just comfort zone? Is it just we kind of have a good time?
Yeah, I mean, it always takes a while to discover how somebody works, and then it's of course helpful if you already know that. I mean, going into a Mangold movie, if I do another Mangold movie, I kind of know his strengths, his weaknesses. I know when he gets upset. I know, you know, how long he can focus on something. I know how he likes to communicate. You know, the him and Alexander are both very, you know, precise and can articulate very well what they want. Others don't, you know, which is also fine. Like, I've done two movies with Gore Verbinski, you know, Mouse Hunt and Weatherman, and, you know, he's different. He's comes from a visual effect world. He says, you know, I wanted more like beep, 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 instead of beep, 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 you know, and like, you know, so everyone's different. And,
right.
And it helps not having to, you know, start from scratch with each director and discover the whole process. And, you know, it's all about the chemistry and the mood you set on set. And I do like the smaller, more intimate movies, which Alexander provides, and where you have a very, his film family, as he labels it, you know, which is really true. I mean, he knows everybody's name on the set. Day one, he gets into a van. He says, hey, Jim, how's it going? You know, how's he? He knows his kid is playing football. And that really creates this feeling of, you know, sort of this film family. And he respects everybody's job. Like, he knows my key grip. It's very, you know, a master of cutting light and Ray Garcia. I mean, he really loves, you know, watching the craft and really respects what everybody does, and down to every PA. And it makes everybody give their best because they feel like, you know, they're. And we do movie night in pre-production, and we every Thursday he cooks, you know, for whoever wants to come over. You know, most we've been on location. We were, you know, in Buellton and in Hawaii and obviously in Norfolk, Nebraska. And, you know, so he has a house usually and cooks and invites people over. He picks a movie once a week that we watch, and that's great, you know. And so not necessarily relates to the movie we're about to do, but.
Right.
You know, the way we prep is we just watch movies, and we don't do shot lists. We don't really talk about references, but we watch movies that we like, that are, like I said, not necessarily specifically looked at for reference. I mean, it's just like, oh, I really love this Japanese movie. And it's black and white, but, you know, it's three people living in a swamp. I mean, it has nothing to do with Nebraska. And and on Descendants, you know, I recommended let's watch Walkabout, you know, I mean, other than it takes place in nature. And, you know, they're not, so it's just because I like the pacing of it, and then he'll show me something, a Hal Ashby movie, or, you know, so that's how we work, really. We just kind of, you know, like, just chat about, and you get a sense of what, you know, what his aesthetics are and how he likes certain, you know, certain pacing and things like that.
So is it your job to match that, to marry that?
No, I mean, my job is to identify what the director wants to do, whether he can communicate it precisely, which Alexander can and others can't. And, you know, I think a good cinematographer is somebody who can sort of identify what he's trying to accomplish, the director, who's ultimately, you know, the auteur of the film, and get as close as to that as possible, you know, and use your own aesthetics and style to come close to what he has in his head, and that's the challenge. And it's nice that it's different every time. That's what makes my job interesting. Yeah, that's.
So somebody like, I mean, besides personality, somebody like Turteltaub, for instance, very kind of straight, golden Hollywood lighting kind of guy. He just wants, you know, he makes pretty pictures and makes the actors look beautiful and all of that. Alexander does not seem to be, you know, focused so much on that as the aesthetic of the overall space.
Yeah, Alexander has more of a réalité or banalité, as he calls it, of things. He's very much into realism. Things need to feel real. For example, if I turn on a practical just because it looks good in the background, he's like, why would that light be on? You know, we always have this argument, how many practicals are on, you know, how many lamps are on. You know, you could never enter a space where a light's already on, because, like, why would you leave a light on? So he always applies this sort of realism logic, and which is great. It's almost like a dogma. And same with the locations. I mean, when we discover a bar or a restaurant we want to shoot in, I mean, we almost always insist on keeping the decor, keeping the actual artwork there. He constantly has arguments and gets into trouble with the studio's legal department, because, you know, nobody can track this, you know, whoever did these four running horses across a grassy field, you know, like some local artist, and they can never find, you know, who so they say, you know, we have no clearance on it. But he likes to, you know, discover things, and then he gets inspired by them, and then wants to maintain sort of the realism of it, and down to the degree where he casts, you know, if we eat in a restaurant that we decide we're going to shoot in, you know, the waitress that serves us that night when we're having our scout also is going to end up being in the movie, the waitress, you know, just like in Nebraska where the karaoke bar, that's actually the waitress, that's her station, and so he mixes in, you know, that not just location, but down to the, you know, the extras and the smaller bit parts are local people, and which is also great for the local community, because it makes them feel like they're part of the filmmaking and they really embrace this. And that was the case in Hawaii and Buellton at the Hitching Post, and of course Nebraska. You know, they really, I mean, him being a homeboy from Nebraska, you know, they really very supportive of us, and it's also a great testament to, you know, sort of capturing that feel of Hawaii, for example, when you get all these people from the islands saying, this is the first time I've seen a movie where I really get a sense of what it's like to live in Hawaii, not just the way the tourist board represents it in Waikiki Beach. And, you know, this is life, you know, daily life in Hawaii, the traffic, the poverty, the contrast between, you know, this, the richness and the wealth of Waikiki, and then, you know, you just go down the street and there's, you know, extreme poverty, and the same with Nebraska. Now when you know, I see people from the Midwest, you know, my agent, for example, she's from Minnesota, and you know, how they relate to it and really feel like we capture something that's, you know, very much, you know, everyone can identify, you know, they either have a relative like Woody or dad like that, and or grew up in a town like that, and they feel like it's really true, and you know, of course it's stylized just because it's black and white, of course. Right. But in a way, it makes it more realistic. But black and white almost gives it a certain realism to it.
So, do you feel that? Are you conscious of, as you're there prepping and scouting and everything else? Is that really what you're trying to capture? Are you thinking, and obviously Alexander is.
Yeah, of course, you know, Alexander is very familiar with Nebraska, but the first thing we did in terms of our preparation for Nebraska was he drove up with his mom's Toyota Corolla to Billings, Montana, and I flew in, and he insisted on, you know, he suggested we drive the actual route. This is months before the movie. And it's not really to look for locations. He just wanted me to get a sense of the vastness of the land and the road trip. So we engaged on this three-day road trip and just drove through, you know, Wyoming and South Dakota, went to Mount Rushmore. You know, once we were in Nebraska, drove through a bunch of towns, you know, and just for me to get a sense of the community and the land. And, you know, it was really strong impressions that resonated all the way through while I was working on it. You know, like one of my impressions was, you know, we would drive into these towns and there'd be a sign that said, you know, population 16,000 or 22,000, and we'd drive down Main Street usually, and, you know, I'd never see anybody. And I'd just come back from Europe and I'd be, you know, where is it? We're like, you know, in Italy, you drive through a small town, the kids running around the piazza, the old men sitting in a cafe, everyone looks at you. And here, there were never any people on the street. So I'm like, Alexander, you're from here, where is everybody? And he was like, you know, I guess inside, you know, watching TV, which, you know, comes back later in the movie. It's this whole motif or the whole notion of, you know, lack of communication, isolation, loneliness. People, you know, we have a bunch of dialogue scenes where no one's making eye contact to each other. Everyone's just staring at the football game. And it was interesting to see all those themes, you know, come to life in the movie that were sort of my first impressions of that. And it's great when you, you know, it feels like, you know, we're doing something that feels real and not created there.
So when Alexander calls up and says, I want to make this movie in black and white, do you jump up and down with the thrill?
Well, I was very excited. I mean, he first talked to me about this while we were prepping Sideways. So, you know, 10 years
ago. A while ago,
And he said, you know, I have a small movie I want to do in Nebraska, and it's in black and white. So to me, it always, so I've known for, you know, 10 years now that one day, hopefully, this will happen. And we'll get to do a black and white movie. And then, you know, in our minds, it always only existed as a black and white film. So on this road trip, you know, I brought my still camera with black and white film. All the first images I generated were in black and white, printed them, looked at them. So we never had it conceived any other way. And it always felt right, you know. And of course, people ask, well, why black and white for this and stuff? And even Alexander really doesn't have an answer for it. I mean, it's. I always say, well, when I started in still photography, you know, I had a film camera with color film loaded and one with black and white film. That's kind of what you had. You had two cameras, and sometimes you just reach for your black and white film camera. It just seems, you know, some images are just better in black and white. And and it just feels, in this particular case, this story feels nice in black and white. I mean, of course, the graphic value, quality of the land, the sky, these wide horizons, then our lonely figures, you know, placed in this landscape. And then Bruce, of course, looks fantastic in black and white because, you know, it's about death. And he's, you know, he has his white glowing hair, and then the texture of his face and all the subtleties of his look are just fantastic in black and white. You don't have any distraction by a palette. And you you know, he's like this ghost-like figure almost. You
is
know?
Lighting that particularly difficult?
No, I actually found it easier to work in black and white. And
but Bruce's head, I mean, particularly.
No, no. I mean, the first day we tested him, and he always tells the story, you know, we walked up, and he walked up onto his mark, and I had the camera on him. I go, this is going to be great. I mean, he looks amazing, you know. He was out in some parking lot where we had our wardrobe set up, and the sun came out and he just glowed like this, and you know, it's just like, you know. And he asked us, what do you want me to do? And he, his favorite quote is, he'll probably tell you, you know, he always says, you know, Alexander said to him, don't do anything, let us find it, you know, or let us discover whatever it is. And it was so easy to, you know, that's every time you shoot a close-up of him, I mean, there's so much going on, you know, all these little subtleties. And I do think that black and white helps all that, you know, come across, because it's just more, you know, graphic in a way. And
so as a cinematographer, what is your relationship with the actors?
It's very important, you know, because you're almost the person who has the most immediate, intimate contact with them. In this case, I operated the camera. Alexander asked me if I could operate, because, you know, from several, I mean, it's a small road movie, we're in cars a lot, it's really not that many people fit in there. It sort of cuts the communication down to the minimum, like, you know, you have a director. With Alexander, we don't have a video village, per se, or, I mean, he's always next to camera, we have a monitor there, or even when we shot film, we had an onboard monitor and no playback. So it's the director, me, who's the cameraman, and the actors. And it feels, you know, it creates this very small, intimate set, which makes everybody comfortable, and you don't have to go through channels of communicating, you know. I think that's, you know, that's the same thing Clooney responded to, and, you know, actors like it, and, you know, we don't do that many takes, you know, it's very precise, you know, sometimes, I mean, we've George, we do one maximum two takes. With Alexander, a little more. He usually take one. He goes, "That was perfect. I think we don't need to." Well, let's just try one more, and then we do four or five more. But still, you know, it's a very a concise process.
Is it different depending on the actor? With Clooney, for instance, had Bill Murray on. You know, there are actors who kind of go off and do other things sometimes.
Yeah, but he doesn't let anyone do any. You know, George knows exactly, and he goes, you know, he does one take, and then he doesn't even want when you give him another opportunity, and he knows when he has what he wants. And
so is there such thing as a best experience for you, or the best kind of director for you?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think, you know, look, when I did Sideways, I told my intern, I had a camera intern, I told her, you know, whatever you experienced on this movie, don't, you know, get into the film industry because of this, because you'll never experience again. And then, you know, he was able to recreate that again on Descendants and Nebraska. So I would say, you know, working with Alexander is very special and very satisfying, you know. And the movies are great, you know, you always want to work on good movies and have movies that people respond to, and so that way you're not wasting your time, you know. I mean, so often you do movies and it's a lot of work. Whether you do a good movie or a bad movie, it's the same amount of work. Actually, it's more work probably in a bad movie. And then, you know, if nobody really, even if they see it because it has a big release, you know, it's just not fun when it's, you know, you don't really like it. So that's why I like to stick with the same directors. I know good directors, and I know that, you know, that they do good movies. So, and then not that many of them.
No.
You know, that not that many choices.
And you only have so much time on your schedule.
And, you know, you only have so many movies in you, in your lifetime. I mean, you know, at this point it becomes more, you know, how many movies I'm going to do? I do maybe one or two a year, and, you know, how many more years? And, you know, I mean, hopefully there'll be more, but, you know, I've done 40 movies and 45 movies, probably features, and, you know, probably 30 of them are not that great. But the last, you know, maybe 10 in a row have been pretty good. So, you know, it's good. It's good when you get to work on better quality stuff.
And what part of the process do you get your most satisfaction from? Are you happiest when it's all together? Or are you happiest in the prep?
No, I really don't like prep. I can't wait to start shooting. Often I think we should forfeit, you know, a week of prep and just have more shooting time, because that's when it happens. And it's those little moments, you get little tiny moments of great joy, and it can be something, just the simple fact that you caught a great little expression of an actor's close-up, and you're super happy about that. And so you have all these tiny little moments, and, you know, the accumulation of all these little jewels is what makes a good movie. And you get a feeling while you're doing it, and, okay, we're getting lots of those. And, of course, with Bruce in Nebraska, we had that a lot. But then again, you still never know, because the movie kind of gets made three times. You know, when you write it, and then when you shoot it, and then, of course, it gets really made in the editing, and that's when you really see how the film is, it sort of gets reinvented. And then it's nice when the feeling you had on set, or you felt like something's working on set, it's confirmed that it actually worked in the final, because it's all these little elements that have to be in perfect harmony. You know, like Walk the Line was good because You know, just the chemistry between Joaquin and Reese, you know, was just something special. You just felt like that's really fascinating to look at. And then that's why it works in the movie later, their dynamic. So, you know, with a different cast, the same movie, same script, same location, same photography would have just not been this good. You're running out of tape.
No, we're just, he's signaling to me 5 minutes, I have to talk.
Yeah.
But do you, I mean, is it ever, wow, that was a beautiful shot that I just created?
Yeah, but those are not necessarily... the moments, yeah, you're happy when you grab a great shot, but you know, unless it works in the story and works for the scene, you know it's not going to be in the movie. So I've been around long enough to not get excited about a beautiful shot. I'm much more excited about when some actor does something fantastic, and even if the lighting was not perfect or ideal, you know, because those are the moments that are important. And you know, of course, you're hoping for, you know, the best light and the best shot to also incorporate the best performance. But
right.
You know, that's what I was saying about, you know, going back and directing also and being in the editing room, you know that, you know, ultimately the stuff that's going to be used is not because it's the best shot. And there are filmmakers who use the best shots because they're the best shots, but
right.
Then, you know, those movies don't necessarily work.
So do you spend any time in post with the director?
I do, you know, I usually come in and see an edit. And we talk about it, and I get to give my thoughts, and then of course, in once it's completed, you know, I go back in and do all the color correction,
yeah.
Which was a fun process, doing black and white on this one and setting all the contrast, and you know, that's in the whole another extension of our creative process. And Alexander is present throughout that, and you know, some directors don't spend that much time in the DI, as we call it, the digital intermediate. And so usually, you know, 2 week process. And it's fun because we get to, you know, fine tune everything just like they do in the mix. And it's nice when you really see it come together and, you know, it's the final touches. And
would you get any surprises when you come back, when you see it all pieced together, or is that?
Yeah, sometimes, you know, sometimes you go like, oh, wow, what happened to, you know, that scene? It's completely gone. You know, it's, yeah, you know, but again, you know, having been in editing, you just know sometimes something works on its own as a great scene individually, but it's just within the flow of the whole story. It doesn't really contribute, or it's repetitive, or it's doing something that has already been accomplished through some something you've discovered, so you don't need to use it. And, you know, often it's really beautiful stuff, but, you know, that's... It's, you know, killing your babies and being able to accept that, you know, hopefully through having done so many movies, it's not a painful experience anymore. You go, oh, okay, I get it, you know, like, I know why my beautiful sunset shot is gone.
It's so sad, though, when it goes. There is already, like, a story, I guess, or legend about a color version of the film.
Yeah.
Did you have to go through and do the technical work on that?
No, I mean, we didn't, and just because we didn't have a huge amount of time to do our DI, so we maximized, of course, our work on the black and white version. And, you know, I have a very good colorist, Skip Kimball, at Technicolor, and then when we were done, you know, there was a little time allowed for the color version, and I had to actually leave. I think I had to go back to London to finish Monuments Men, and I said to him, you know, now just do whatever you always wanted to do, and nobody ever let you. And Alexander, you know, we had talked about, you know, we switched to color during the shoot, just the monitor or in the DI, and just looked at it in color. And we go, oh, that's kind of, I mean, on set we go, oh, that's horrible. Like, how can we ever shoot color again? You know, our heads become so much wrapped into the black and white. But in the DI, sometimes we looked at something like really saturated and sort of like Kodachrome colors faded, you know, from, you know, the 70s or 80s. And we said, oh, maybe we should do, you know, not what people would expect, like a desat version, but like a really saturated version of it and really go crazy. So I kind of left it up to Skip. I could just go, do whatever you feel like. And I haven't seen it, but apparently it looked pretty good. And Alexander called me. He goes, it looks really kind of cool in color. I'm like, I hope you don't like it better than the black and white. But he said, no. So, but I haven't seen it. We haven't really been told or found out where and who requires the color version.
Right.
I heard HBO, but ultimately I hope the movie now exists in people's minds and has been accepted as a black and white movie, just like Raging Bull, or, you know.
Is it weird to have a little odd twin out there?
Yeah, I guess one day I will maybe see it somewhere, but maybe on HBO.
And what does all this award stuff mean to you? How does it fit in? Do you?
It's always nice when awards. I mean, Alexander goes very silly unless you win, you know. But it's always fun to have a movie that is liked, you know. To me, the biggest award is getting the audience, seeing the movie with an audience and having the audience reactions. I was just in Poland at Camera March. It's a great cinematography festival. And just to see how people are taking in this, you know, the shots that just get laughs even before the dialogue starts, you know, like the group shots of the, mm-hmm. the all the brothers watching the football game, and like that frame comes up and it gets a reaction, and it's just nice to see, you know, okay, these things that we thought of and we composed so carefully, mm-hmm. and this movie is very much about composition and sort of a pace, and playing a lot of scenes are played in a wonder, and you know, it allows the audience to take in details, just, you know, a little bit like Jarmusch did in Stranger in the Paradise, where you just sort of are allowed to, you're not being forced or manipulated by the edits to, okay, look at this reaction shot, look at the insert of the turkey. I mean, this is, you know, I can scan the frame and find things in it, and it's nice when you see an audience, you know, that it's been effective, and an audience is reacting to these things and enjoys the frame, and so that's, you know, the most fun part. Of course, I'm happy for Bruce getting all this attention, you know, and also people having told him, you know, go for supporting actor, and him insisting I'm going for lead actor category, and him winning all these critics award mm-hmm. things, and it's great to see that he's being recognized, and you know.
So what is the deal in Poland? Because I always think that I need to, like, I saw a documentary about it actually at Glasgow last year, or Edinburgh last year. And it seems amazing, but I also kind of feel like if I ever showed up, I'd be kind of infringing on
there are a lot of intimacy. It's really a filmmakers festival. I mean, not just cinematographers. We get lots of, you know, David Lynch goes a lot, Oliver Stone, a lot of filmmakers from Europe. It's a student film competition. I was on the jury this year with Caleb Deschanel, and there are about 2,500 film students that show up from 50 film schools mm-hmm. from around the world. So you get people from Bangladesh, South America, of course all the big, you know, USC, UCLA, AFI, but then small Polish films, and mm-hmm. And you know, they're all filmmakers. It's not so, you know, there's no market, it's not star-driven, you know. I mean, Jon Turteltaub came and showed his directorial effort, the last picture. Mm-hmm. You get to see movies that you wouldn't have an opportunity to see often, and you know, of course it's cold and it gets dark at 3 o'clock, so it really lends itself just to watching a lot of films and then mm-hmm. drink a lot of vodka and to, you know, meet all these people that you would never meet, you know.
It does seem to create a community for cinematographers that might not otherwise.
No, but it's not just cinematographers, you know. There are lots of directors come and you know, there are photo exhibits, and you know, a lot of us do many things. You know, there are photo exhibits, still photo exhibits from directors sometimes, or cinematographers, or books that they publish, and mm-hmm. you know, the lighting workshops, you know, all the new equipment is displayed, you know, air responses at Kodak, Panavision, mm-hmm. So you get to catch up on all the new technology, but not like, you know, at NAB or
the
something,
sales convention.
I mean, you know,
yeah.
Sales convention, you know, it's great.
So, and how are you on the new technology? Is that
look? My theory is, I realize I can't really keep up and stay up to speed with everything that's constantly developed. So I usually wait till I have a project, mm-hmm. Which, you know, you never really know when that will be, and maybe my next project will be in 4 months, and so there's no point in me continuously testing things. But when I have a project, and then I look at the material, and then I decide like what tools are available to me, and I test those tools that exist at that particular moment, because, you know, even now there's black and white monochromatic Alexa and digital cameras that didn't exist when we did Nebraska, which might have been, you know, nice to use, but mm-hmm. You know, you really just, when you have your assignment and you know this is the kind of story I want to tell, this is how I want it to look, what are the best tools at that moment? And then I test, you know, like on Nebraska, I tested black and white film, color film, digital cameras, and mm-hmm. you know, we decided this would suit our purpose for this configuration of shooting the best. And then, you know, I test that for myself. Well, you know, it's a small road movie, you know, where I wanted a camera that we could use low light. I knew I didn't want to carry a big lighting package. So, you know, we shot a lot in the cars, also at night without lighting. And, you know, the Lexus has higher sensitivity. A lot of these street scenes at night have minimal lighting. And, you know, we're a small, low budget road movie. It's nice to, you know, not carry a lot of.
So was it a mixture of cameras ultimately, or was
no,
it?
No, we shot, well, after testing, mm-hmm. and we had to dismiss the black and white film stock because Paramount had asked us for a color version as well. So we had to pick a, you know, so between the color film stock and the Alexa digital mm-hmm. camera, we first, of course, shot, I did test the black and white film stock just to have it as a reference. Right. We also asked for Paramount to give us a print of Paper Moon that we projected and examined, you know, the film grain, because I did add actual film grain and wanted to achieve, you know, in this case, I wanted this older mm-hmm. Film look. And you'd be surprised how much grain it is. I mean, people notice it, but, you know, we're just not accustomed to it anymore. Yeah. But if you look at an old black and white film, I mean, it's very much alive, you know, it has this texture.
Particularly so, when they blow them up to HD now and yeah. you see everything.
And of course, you know, all the projection, our DCPs, digital cinema packages, so ultimately they get projected digitally anyway, 99%. Mm-hmm. Only foreign, I think, they still deliver prints, if they do. And, you know, so we digitized the black and white film stock, and I said to Skip, can you match the color stock to it? You know, black and white, and mm-hmm. and the contrast and the grain, and then can you do the same thing with Alexa? And he did it fairly effortlessly. It took him about 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. And I said, was that easy? He goes, yeah. Was it easier on the film versus the digital? He goes, no, it's about the same. Actually, you know, we have nice latitude and very low end sensitivity in the digital camera, which really mm-hmm. suited our purposes. So then we decided on that because it just gave us other advantages, you know.
So you have no practical fear of technology? You're not like, I need to have
no, not really. I mean, I did just see Gravity, and I texted to Chivo. I said, you know, I have no idea how you did any of that. I mean, so, but I mean, I've, you know, I did movies like Mouse Hunt. I mean, I remember sitting in pre-production meetings on Mouse Hunt with the storyboard, and pretty much everyone in the room was like, I mean, Gore had come up with all of that, but like I don't think anybody knew how we would accomplish mm-hmm. that. And I was just listening to Alfonso and Emanuel Lubezki talk about it. Mm-hmm. Like, when did your experimental phase end? And they go, never did, you know. They were just constantly, you know, figuring things out as they did it. But that's the challenge. And I do think you can accomplish everything as long as you have a director who knows what he wants. And mm-hmm. you know, he basically, Chiva was just saying, Alfonso is so stubborn, you know, he just insists on accomplishing what he wrote, which is great, you know. That's mm-hmm. the great challenge for us to you know, that's our job, to deliver, you know, whatever the director can think of and envision. And you never want to say, you know, I can't do that, you know. That's the, I mean, that's my number one thing. I always want to find a way to be able to deliver that, you know?
We were actually having a conversation with John Schwartzman the other day about yeah. the films and how, you know, the technology they used up using in the box for the actors is being used now pretty much everywhere, has been for a long time, for car, you know, for moving driving scenes and things.
Right.
And that projecting onto the LEDs is not actually a new concept, but that they used it in a different way and just figured out another method.
Right.
The
right.
same technology has already been kind of.
Yeah,
there.
And you know, we mix. I mean, I consider myself more a traditional, old-fashioned kind of cameraman. I mean, I started in film, and I always, you know, my approach has always been simplicity and the least amount of lighting units and playing with natural light or using or examining a location and seeing, you know, how can I use the natural light as much as possible, because my influences were, you know, Robbie Miller and all those, you know, the French New Wave and German New Wave, that, you know, all those guys didn't have anything. You know, they didn't have equipment. They had to, you know. So that's my background, and not having gone really through, you know, traditional film school. I mean, at Roger Corman, we would just also, you know, build our own lights, and I still very much do that. And, you know, you find a combination of old techniques and old things that work and new technology that you can take advantage of, you know, the higher sensitivity. And, you know, right now I'm being lit with LEDs, which, you know, just 5 years ago, we've had a completely different light kit here, and you know, that's all great. It's less hot, it takes less space, all these things. I mean, it's silly not to take advantage of them, but I'm not intimidated by it. I like it, and also I'm not a sentimentalist in that sense. Like, you know, if I'm recording onto a hard drive or if it's actually film, I mean, ultimately that's not what's important, you know. I mean, especially if it gets to the point where you can't tell the difference, really, and I'm having a very hard time really distinguishing, you know, what was shot digitally and what was shot on film. But, you know, ultimately, the composition, the storytelling, mm-hmm. the performances are all, you know, all those job descriptions of us capturing that and telling a story visually are still the same. I mean, it doesn't matter if what it gets recorded onto, you know.
It's just who's doing the recording, I guess.
Yeah.
Or who's creating the shot and who's...
Yeah, of course, you know. And I mean, if John Cassavetes was directing today, he would be using probably not even a Red, he'd be probably using an iPhone or something. You know, I mean, he would just... The camera was always just the slave to the actor. I mean, you had to, you know, you couldn't do anything. Couldn't set any marks or light it, you know, restrict the actors in any way. So, you know, there's certain tools that make, of course, you know, David Lean wouldn't have used a small digital camera, you know. So there are tools for, you know, it depends on the story also. There's some stories mm-hmm. that are grander in scale and more cinematic. And others, you know, like Faces would have probably been shot on a small digital camera, you know. But and you know what? It would have been just as good.
Yeah. Well, people are, I mean, it's interesting to watch the people fighting the fight for the last, you know, vestiges of film. And, you know, but it seems like, as you say, we're getting...
Well, you know, a lot of them are fighting it because they feel like they're losing control of their craft. Like the cinematographers feel like, you know, we were always had a mystique to what we did. You know, everybody thinks they can write and direct and edit, but we were the guy talking to the lab and had a viewing glass and a light meter and doing spot readings, and you know, they kind of knew what we're supposed to do, but they didn't know how to do it. Like, they couldn't really. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, they just walk up to a monitor and anyone can give an opinion to what you see on the monitor, which has the LUT on it, the lookup table, and you were looking at something that's close to the final product. So, you know, it allows people to make a comment on it. You know, is that going to be this dark, or is he silhouette, or, you know, whereas before you said, you know, this is going to play like this,
right.
You would have to, but I actually like it because, you know, of course, you don't want to be working with people you don't have the same intentions, you know, but if you have a director and you're pursuing the same goal, I think it's a helpful tool to be able to look, like with Alexander, to be able to discuss, you know, do you want it this dark? And he's like, yeah, it's great. You know, can we make it even darker? Can he be really silhouette? I don't want to see. And I don't have to go, yeah, this is four stops under. It's going to go black. Mm-hmm. You know, really, I want to see it. No, here I can actually discuss it. So I think, you know, they can actually encourage you to take more chances and stuff because they actually see the product. So,
well, the magic seems to be in those choices, not in the fact that you can do it, but that
right,
how you do it.
Right. Now, of course, you know, if you're working with people that you're not on the same page, and, you know, which is something you want to avoid in general, whether you're shooting film or, you know, the advice number one is, you know, work with people that are trying to make the same movie you are or you want to make. And have the same taste, you know. Ultimately, it's just different opinions and taste, you know. Between Turteltaub and, you know, Gore, and I mean, everyone has different sensibilities. So, but if you're in sync on that, you know, it's great. But of course, in television, I mean, you know, I mean, I don't do television, but you know, I know people feel like, you know, that there's a whole committee by the monitors, or you know, commercials. Obviously, I shoot sometimes, and you know, it becomes. Now the monitor becomes sort of this area where you get a lot of, you know, cooks all mixing in,
yeah.
and then that can be distractive. But of course, with working with Clooney and with Alexander, you don't have that. I mean, we don't direct by committee.
Not too many stories about a lot of cooks making a good stew.
No.
It's almost always that one.
Yeah.
And
that's why, you know, those sets, like, are very important that they become sort of streamlined just to the people that are actually making the movie, you know. There's nobody there who doesn't, you know, there's a boom guy. I mean, in the room, the actors, there's a boom guy, there's a cameraman, there's me, a lighting cameraman, and an operator, and the director, and the script supervisor. and you won't find anybody else in that room. We don't really do last touches with hair and makeup. Mm-hmm. George doesn't put any makeup on.
Looks perfect. Is that what
Matt
you're
Damon
is?
Does? He gets ripped a lot by George because Matt actually takes a while. But George, literally, I mean, he never, nothing. Mm. And we just, you know, it's just the essence of the filmmakers, the craftsmen involved on that particular shot. Nothing else.
It's a good way to go.
Yeah.
It's what everybody kind of dreams of. It's that the everybody complains about Hollywood and everything else, but that's, you know. They still make those movies,
and then, you know, these big machines, they become like sort of this decadent, huge machinery, and you feel like you have this, you know, weight tied to your foot, and filmmaking is all about being able to react and being spontaneous and take advantage of little situations, like the light is changing, and like, can we actually go over here and do this, and you can't do it when you have this gigantic machine, you know. Mm. You gotta move base camp. I mean, you know, there's two of the biggest issues with George and Alexander. It's like all these vehicles, all this staff, you know. It's like, but I want to shoot over there. I don't understand, like, why all these cars parked there?
It's no like, base camp with Alexander.
Well, no, but it's never, you know, anywhere near us.
Keep it away.
And with George also, first thing he comes to set, he's like, what is all this, you know? I mean, we were doing a World War II movie with, you know, 500-600 extras. I mean, you know, it's like you have to explain to him, and somebody actually has to address these people. I mean, he knows all that. It's just like, you know, you come and you're the director, you just, you know, want to focus in on like your frame, and then everything else becomes a distraction. Yeah. Mm.